Good morning. Let's try it again. Good morning.
Good morning.
Awesome. My job is to keep you all awake this morning, make sure we send you out on the floor with a good positive attitude. My name's Chris Miller. I'll be your trainer this morning. How many people sat in my session yesterday, Gorilla Pet Story? Anybody? Good, because it's all duplication of yesterday. So you're going to get about 75 minutes of yesterday's four-hour session, and we're going to talk about merchandising, a little bit on lighting, and we're going to cover lighting a whole lot more at 2 o'clock today with the visual end, because I'm just going to give you the basics on lighting and how it ties in with merchandising. And then this afternoon, we're going to talk about visual merchandising, the creative end, and how to take your merchandising to that next level. So this is an intro, and then we have the advanced this afternoon at 2 o'clock. Now, when you do come back at 2 o'clock, if you do, there will be the same 10 commandments in there, but I'm not going to talk about it because it's a foundation for, obviously, the advanced class. So I threw that in there for the advanced class. If by chance you can't make the afternoon session and still need the handout, I can certainly email that to you, or they may have some extras upon exiting. I want to make sure everybody did get a handout on the power of merchandising that I put together, 10 commandments. And also, if you got a seminar eval sheet that I'd like you to fill out at the end, appreciate that. I'd like to hear your comments. Has anybody sat in one of my sessions before? Raise your hand. Be honest. 3, 4, back for more, huh? All right. Well, thank you for attending. I've been designing retail stores for quite a long time, and before that I designed warehouses. In warehouses, you want people to walk the least amount of distance to pick an order. And I used a lot of the ergonometrics that I learned in that industry in the 70s, and all the distributors that we worked on, pet store, natural food, electronics, all distributed to retail. And they kept saying, did a great job on our warehouse and our offices. Can you help our stores? They don't know who to go to. And I said, why don't we? I mean, they're asking us every job we do. We need help. Their retailers need help with shelving and lighting and refrigeration and all these kinds of things. Why can't we do it? And eventually, you know, if people ask you enough, you say, hey, why not? Let's pick up some lines and space planning. So we started doing it in the late 70s, and I started this company in 81 and never looked back. Basically 3,000 stores, and I stopped counting about 10 years ago. I learn on every store. I don't know it all. I learn on every store. Retail is evolving and changing, and I just really enjoy doing these seminars and getting all the knowledge from all the stores we've worked on and being able to train you guys so you can take it back and implement in your stores. There's a little bio in the back. We do have a booth here if you want to set up a free consultation. Also, we're doing phone appointments for next week. It's a new thing we're offering for stores that just have a few questions and want to send in some pictures or a sketch or an idea, and they want to pick my brain for a half hour, 45 minutes on the phone. I'd be happy to do that for free. I'm here to help. We're very value-added. I don't look at just stores from one standpoint. I look at it from an umbrella effect. Yesterday, we talked about the four basic areas of a retail store. It's the outside, inside, merchandising, and employees. Today we're going to talk about just the merchandising for the most part. And we're going to start out my session with, I call it my attention getter. For those people that have sat in my session before, you probably saw this, but there, so you can't play this game. But I ask everybody, how many people like this $20 bill? How many people like a nice new $20? Everybody? Okay, now here's the trick part. Who is willing to do something to get it? First hand up, come on up here. Uh-oh. What's your name?
Noel.
Where are you from?
Wildwood, Florida.
Wildwood, Florida. You're a local boy, local girl, huh?
Mm-hmm.
And how come you're so special with all these little...
I don't know, the lady told me. She's like, you can get whichever ones you want, so I did.
There's your 20. You don't have to do anything for it than other ones you just did. Give her a hand. That's all she has to do.
Thank you.
What did we just learn here? What's that? Raise your hand quickly.
Opportunity knocks.
Actually, she was willing to come out of her comfort zone. She was willing to take a risk, right? I can write this all down. Very important thing that I learned a long time ago. Successful people are comfortable being uncomfortable. Successful people are comfortable being uncomfortable. They're willing to try change. They're willing to do something different. They're willing to get out of their comfort zone. Important lesson I want you to take back with your stores. Couple that with a good positive attitude, enthusiasm will take you everywhere in life. It's important that you take back a good positive attitude and take back some of these ideas and concepts and actually implement them in your store. These are easy, sweat equity, bolt-on techniques. Now, when you're out visually shopping in the retail marketplace, pen industry or otherwise, what retail store stands out in your mind that does a really good job visually? One store, one thing that you like about them visually. What, Apple, what do you like about Apple? One thing. It's bright. I call it exciting. Right? And it's clean, which I'm going to write it down. Because you can't fix clean. We're going to talk about clean and how to implement a cleaning schedule in your store that is non-negotiable. How about that? Make it easy to delegate and set non-negotiable standards in your store. Easy bolt-on stuff. Because who taught you how to retail? Guy down the street. Who taught him? Guy down the street. Who taught him? The guy down the street. So everybody's copying everybody, but nobody knows why. So I'm going to give you the tools and the basic concepts of retailing and how to go back and implement them in your store. What other store stands out in your mind visually that does a great job? Yes? Ann Taylor Loft. What do you like? The one thing about Ann Taylor Loft?
Minimal.
It's minimalistic. It's simple. Or easy to shop? They definitely, along with the Gap Kids and Gap, does a great job visually of letting you see the product, and they get rid of the visual train wreck every place else. And you go into the average pet store, an average USA downtown, you walk into, and it is a dog's breakfast at best. It is so many things going on. And we're going to talk about how that clutter and that visual clutter and how to minimize it in certain ways to make it your store appear easier to shop and simpler by using some of the techniques I'm going to teach you this morning. Good. Anybody else have a store that stands out in your mind visually that is a really great job? Yes?
Anthropology.
What do you like about Anthropology?
The storefront, the way that they...
That curb appeal. Smell, important thing in pet stores. We have lots of smells we have to deal with. The bulk products, the smoky bones. If you have animals, ventilation. There's a lot of dog food smells. You know, there's a lot of smells that you have to overcome. Very good. Anybody else have a favorite store visually they like to shop, and what's one thing about it that you like about it? I think it's called the Black and White store.
Black and White.
Yeah.
It's very, in that sense, organized. You know what they're doing?
It's organized.
Yeah, it's
simple, easy, but from the standpoint, it's what else? What was the other word?
About the palette. Organized.
I think that was the word.
You know where you're
going. Okay. Well organized. Anybody else have another store?
Trader Joe's.
What do you like about Trader Joe's?
Quality.
Good.
Low prices.
Now, some would beg to differ about low prices. They do have low price visibility, but in general, I always leave there spending a lot more money than anyplace else. The reason is they have good quality products you can't get anyplace else, and they have some great snacks, let me tell you. My wife will attest to that. And cheap wine. You know, my wife hates it when I whine, and she says if I gain any more weight, she's going to put me in the corner and burn incense in front of me. Anyhow, but anybody else have one more? I got room for one more item. Favorite store I like to shop there?
Trader Joe's is kind of fun.
It is fun. It's got that down-home feeling, but it is fun. And I think that's a good thing we should focus on, because we're selling lifestyle merchandise. We're selling family items. I mean, the pets, companion animals are part of the family, without a doubt. People spend more dollars on their animals than they do on their children. It's amazing. People aren't even having kids anymore. They're having dogs and cats. It's beyond control how much money they spend on their animals. Somebody told me back a few years ago, between dog food and all the other pet products, it's like number four industry in the world. It's huge. You got housing, you got food, and you got cars, and then it's pets. I mean, it's way up there. So there's a lot of people spending a lot of money on pet specialty. So with that being said, think about these things that are conducive to shopping environments that you need to go back with a fresh set of eyes and look at your store from these concepts, and how can I make my store a better place to shop? Because visually, these things are things that stand out in people's minds. Clean being a very important one of them. You can't fix clean, right? Using these tools and training the staff and doing your curb appeal. Curb appeal came up on that list. Curb appeal. Let people know something happened outside. If you don't let them know something happened, there's no motivation to come into your store. So if there's no advertising, there's no grand reopening, there's no event, how do you let people know? They walk in after you re-merchandise. But after you did re-merchandise, people walk in, they go, wow, it's bigger in here. Or wow, what did you do? Right? But that's your existing customers. Your job is to get new customers in here, and then the existing customers, you want them to buy more merchandise. You want your average ticket to go up. You want your items per ticket to go up, right? So these are the tools I'm going to teach you how to do that, and our 10 best merchandising tips. Number one is clean your store. I have a saying, if there's time to lean, there's time to clean, right? Now, if they're standing at the front counter and they're not doing anything, what's wrong? Everything. If you're occupying space and you're not doing something, you are doing something wrong. This is a non-negotiable standard. Okay? Now, what I normally do is I put on a list, on a little 3x5 card, greet the customer with enthusiasm. Positive, smile. Number two, face in front. We'll talk about it in a second. Number three, clean a 4-foot section. Number four, put away merchandise and mark merchandise. Number five, go back to number one. If you're occupying space and you're not doing any of these things, you're worthless to me. I exchange paychecks for exceptional customer service and exceptional behavior. Not average. We don't give away C's here. We don't give away B's. We give away B pluses, A minuses, and A's. That's how we roll. And this is what your expectations are. If you're staying at the counter and you're talking about Saturday night or where you're going with the staff, and you got the little groupies going on, you are going to fire yourself. Okay? That's a non-negotiable standard. I pay you to work. I don't pay you to stand. If you learn how to merchandise, which I'm going to teach you, you do it with two hands, and you're always busy. People walk up to a busy employee rather than them standing behind the counter to ask questions. It breaks down a sales wall. I don't know if you've ever noticed that. When you're busy, they'll interrupt you. But if you're standing behind the counter, they go away from you. Oops, salesperson. They go their way. Right? Now, I'm sorry. Let me back up. Clean the store. Now, clean a 4-foot module. If you go back and you say, well, see that 20 feet of shampoos? I need you to clean that section. Is that going to happen in their shift? But can they commit to one 4-foot module? Now, do we clean with a duster? Why?
It just moves
the dust around, right? How do we clean?
Wet rag,
wet rag over your shoulder, pull the product off, wipe it down, put it back, and look at the dates. Key, all right? Now, there's a difference between objective and subjective expectations. Does anybody know the difference between subjective and objective? Give me an example. Subjective. Tommy, I need you to take out the trash. Okay? So he goes over to the big trash can, he takes it out to the trash, brings it back in, forgets to put the liner in it. Right? Leaves the back door open, forgets to lock it. That's take out the trash. Well, we have trash cans at the desk, two at the front counter. We got one at the fish packing station. We have one in the back room. We got one in the restroom, in both restrooms. And then I think we have one near the front door outside in the front. So there's about seven trash cans in our operation. And each one has a liner. So we have five small liners, three big ones. So write it down how it's done. Get them to sign it, put it in their employee file, have it hanging on the wall where the plastic bags are. And this is how we take out the trash. You grab five small ones, three big ones. You go to the big trash can with the wheels. And we go to all these stations. We empty the trash, tie it in a knot, put it in there, and put a new bag in. And we go out to the trash, unlock the lid, dump it in, relock the lid, lock the back door, put a liner in the big one, and you're done. That's how we take out the trash. That is objective. And it's non-negotiable. And everybody does it the same way. And it sounds really, really tough to do things that way because you'd think that they should know this, but they don't. So that's the difference when you train how you can be objective versus subjective. If you want to have your life go smooth, this is how we roll. These are non-negotiable standards. When they come in to get their time card, what we've done, what I recommend, is reducing your floor plan down to, it's like, can this guy talk more about cleaning? Oh. You reduce your floor plan. Here's my checkout counter. Here's my gondola. This is end cap one. This is end cap two. This is gondola one, gondola two, gondola three, four. You get the hint. Wall one, wall two, all the way around. So we've got our floor plan and everything's keyed with a code. And they come in, they get their time card, they punch in, they look what code they gotta do, and they're cleaning gondola three. That's their job, that shift, to clean gondola three. By the time you get 30 days, what happens? The whole store's been detailed. And a lot of times, stuff's been cleaned two and three times. If you have a lot of sets near the front of the store or the back where there's a lot of dirt and dander that happens, you may need to clean those a little bit more often. So you might put that on the secondary clean for the day if you have extra time. Here's a number one. There's another one to do. Hey, we got 6 feet of snow today. It's not going to be real busy. I think you can clean like five sets. Let me give them to you. So they're not occupying space and taking up air and standing behind the counter. Does that make sense? It makes it easy to delegate. It's non-negotiable. Because if they don't follow customer store policy, they end up firing themselves, don't they? I didn't fire you. You're just not doing company policy. Takes that onus off of you. Face in front, continually all the time. I like to face in front when I sell. So if I hand a bottle of shampoo to somebody or any product or on a peg hook, I hand it to the customer, they look at it, I instantly go and I face in front right behind myself. Why? What? I'm already there. I don't have to go back and face in front later on, right? And they don't have a place to put it back. This is the right product for you. Plus it's in their hand, right? You got a 50-50 chance now they're going to buy it, if not better. In the liquor business I grew up in, you had to face in front with two hands. And you did it all the time. It was, it's in your blood. I go to see customers and I see three people standing behind the register and it looks like a war zone all the way around. And I'm going like this, waiting on them. And they're like, are you a rep or something? I said, no, I'm just waiting for the owner. And then I go, they come walking out. I said, you sat in my seminar. Look at this set over here. It looks horrible. Look at that one. He goes, who did that? He says, I did it while I was talking to you. It's either in your blood or it isn't. So wet towel over your shoulder, face in front continually all the time. We're not selling shelf space or slot wall in our stores. So bring the labels right out to the front. Spread to fill. Got an empty hook, an empty shelf. Obviously, we want to spread to fill. So if this sells through, if I sell this one out, that's gone, I go ahead and I double face a product. Why do I do that? It's full and abundant. Abundance sells. This means I'm out of stock and I can't afford, and it's old product. This means I'm ready to sell. What do I instantly think? Let's say you walk into a store and we got the spaghetti sauce section. And you see one facing of Ragu and all the other brands and Bertolini's, and all of a sudden you got two facings of garlic mushroom, Newman's. What do you instantly think about that one? Sells better, right? They're giving it two facings. It must be a better seller. Well, what if it's one they make more margin on? Or one is maybe not selling really well, so you need to get some sell-through on it, so I'm going to double face it or triple face it. And then they say, well, what if I have a tag right here for that product? What do I do? Because it's not there. You flip the tag over. And then when that product comes in, flip the tag back around. And you always do the one to the right. So you know, remember that this is the one for both of those. So you have something that's non-negotiable, how you do it. And if it's on a peg hook, you flip it over. Because there's two facings, they can see the two, and they can see the price. So either one, it doesn't matter, however you want to do it. I would probably do the left one, because people read to the right. So that would probably be better. Question?
Should we show pricing on the front or on the back?
I'm getting there. Two-finger rule. It's not hang loose, it's called hang tight. Now, we talked about merchandising a four-foot section, right? So when you go back and do a reset, you think about a four-foot module. You put the big products on the bottom, two fingers, set a shelf, product, two fingers, boom. Work your way up. Same with peg items. You want them nice and close left to right, but just enough room to get in and face in front. Now, this is an average rule, two fingers, because space kills sales. We don't want to have big distances between things. One of the things you need to be aware of, certain products take a little bit more room to reach in and face in front. Cat can. You can't do it with two fingers. You need to have like a little bit more because they all get knocked over when you reach in. So it has to be almost as thick as your arm to reach in there and face in front. Otherwise, it takes a lot of time. So dependent upon the product, how close you get the shells. It could be less than that if it's just bagged dog food because the top's floppy and you can get almost right to it. So you don't even have to do two-finger roll for 4 and 12-pound bags of 8-pound bags of food. So it's just a rule of thumb. No pun intended. The eye's a camera and it doesn't like this, right? And what happens is you walk into a store and you got all this noise going on in the store and it's like, I can't spend any more time here, I gotta leave. You gotta get rid of the visual train wrecks and the graphic pollution in your stores. We talk about the Ann Taylor store, simple and easy to buy, the black and white store. And you have to rethink the way you merchandise in your store because you have this going on. So color blocks and color breaks are a great way to create a block of color in the store, and the eye stops and goes, oh, how nice. If you have treats in a section and you have some packaging that's similar, different brands, but they're blue or in the blue range or the yellow or greens, try merchandising them vertically. Now this works great for collars and leashes, and it works great for dog foods and some foods and treats, but think of verticalization of your store. Now, can you do that in every 4-foot section? No. Can you do it every 8 to 12 feet? Yes. And be coherent of how you can create some color blocks and color breaks within the store, especially good sellers. Buy a little bit extra so you can do a color block so the eye stops and goes down. Does that make sense? So, store design, we talked about getting circular traffic flow, getting people to walk further in the store by using categories management, of higher foot trafficked items in the back, trying to get a different path in and a different path out, where to put the checkout counter, setting things at 45 degree angles, putting lights where you want people's eyes to stop and spend more time, and using color blocks and color breaks to make the eye stop, go, ah, isn't that nice, and move down. It's called ribboning the merchandising. If you want the eye to go this way, run the color left or right. But what happened, they missed everything else. If you can run it down to the items where, around their knees and shins, there's an 80% difference between shin level and eye level of the sellability. Make sense? So that's why in the supermarkets, Procter & Gamble pays for prime real estate. Everything sells at this level. The average consumer in the United States is extremely lazy. They do not like to bend over, and whatever at this level sells. But if we can create a color block and bring their eye down, we can force more visibility in the store so we can double and triple the impressions within the same buying environment. Pretty cool, huh? So you got a set. There's nothing visually that blocks my eye to say, wow, that's really cool, or I need to spend all my time there. This is more of a visual train wreck. This is a bad example. However, can you color block your inventory to make it simple and appealing to the eye so it can relax and spend more time there? Now, in the clothing business, it's done white on the left, black on the right, and the rainbow in between. You group your plaids together, your stripes together, your black and whites together, and then you have your E-crew, and it works through your yellows, all of the rainbow, all the way over to black. And don't worry about so much merchandising by manufacturer, because they want you to, but people buy by color first, then you size within a color. Think about it. People buy by color first, and then you size within a color. Larger, more expensive item on the right. Why do we do that? 80% of the population is right-handed, but the English language is read from left to right. So now we have a chance to sell a product with more margin, or a higher profit margin, or, I said that twice, didn't I? More profitability, or just a larger sale. Now, if you wanna promote something that you maybe make more margin on, put it on the right. But typically, the larger, more expensive item goes to the right. If you want a good parking spot in the parking structure, go to the left. You'll find your parking fairy. Price it on the back or the bottom. Why do we do that? So people have to pick it up. Manufacturers spend tens of thousands of dollars on the marketing of that label and the packaging and what's on it. Price it on the back or the bottom, and don't put the price over the description and the features and benefits, because people pick it up, and then you put a story behind the product. You got a 50-50 chance if they pick it up. Now, question.
What's your opinion on just bin labels and not price?
Okay, we're in the pet specialty market. If you have a 10,000 square foot store and you're not selling customer service and you're selling price, and if you can find it, you'll buy it, price it on the shelf, and don't worry about it, and hopefully it's priced correctly and you don't upset the customers that come to the counter. Small pet specialty stores, I think, should price it on the back of the bottom, because they want to have change, and their inventory changes so much, and they sell through, they can't get replenished, so then they have to double face, triple face, and to be changing labels like that, it's a little bit burdensome, okay? So I personally, if I had a store, it was up to maybe 7,000-8,000 square feet, and I only had one or two stores, I would be pricing everything on the back or the bottom, and I would do some things that were high movers that never changed, I might do on the shelf. Especially price visible items that I'm proud of, the pricing. Could be cat litter or some of the food. Okay? So that's my story. But yours is gonna be different. You gotta look in the mirror and see what works for you.